Warning, this video is intended for a mature audience. You understand? Viewer discretion is advised. Yay! All right, this is Billy Bob Tanley here, people, and this is a request from King Dismal, and it was uploaded by The Geek Critique, and the name of this video is The Modern Magic of Donkey Kong Country Returns, Geek Critique. Okay, let's check it out. Yay! All right, here we go. This video is part of a series analyzing Donkey Kong Country. Yeah! If you haven't seen the earlier episodes, yeah, I've seen the earlier episodes.
In the mid-90s, just for a little while, it seemed as though Donkey Kong ruled the gaming world. The franchise and its characters seemed at times to surpass even Mario as the de facto face of Nintendo.
Fast forward to
the late 2000s, though, and it was tough to be a Donkey Kong fan. More than
there
a dozen
easy
years
games,
have passed
though.
Since the last entry in the mainline Country series. The GameCube era saw the franchise bound with gimmicky
it's
bongo
all right.
controller. An era when the best offerings were remakes of games from days gone by.
Super Nintendo
that,
all the
more
way
more,
still
it like
to
Donkey
this very
Kong
day.
Was no longer a franchise player. He was just an ancillary part of the
just
Mario
Just a fucking
cast.
Joke.
And by the end of the
Mario
decade,
Party
it was
and
getting
stuff.
Tough to be a traditional Nintendo fan.
Weird.
Early
on,
I remember
the
that commercial.
Was very well supported with games for the casual and hardcore alike. But when it became obvious
Come
just
on,
how
man.
Overtly the console had caught fire,
they
with
just
people
don't
who
care
didn't
about
consider
Donkey
themselves
Kong
gamers,
anymore.
The company doubled down on that demographic. And look, I'm not a gatekeeper for real gamers
I don't care
or whatever.
About that game.
I thought it was awesome
Sports
that I had games
shit.
I could play with my parents.
Suck my fucking
it
cock.
Just felt like it may have been coming a little bit at the expense of people who'd been longtime fans of the company. I remember a year where it seemed like all Nintendo had was
what
Animal
that?
Crossing.
Animal
that was
Crossing,
supposed to be
yeah.
enough for us while Nintendo worked on
That's
Wii Music,
not my
Wii
thing.
Fit,
I'm not a big Animal
Vitality
Crossing
sensor.
Fan.
But, you know, water under the bridge, I'm not going to be bitter.
The
point is,
stuff.
Nintendo was so successful with this strategy
stop
that by 2010, even gamers who didn't give a crap about Nintendo had
PS3,
reason to be anxious. Sony and Microsoft had seen the Wii success,
Stupid
and
Wii
they were tipping
remotes.
Their toes
I
in that,
hate that
big
shit.
Blue ocean. So it's kind of funny. At the very same E3 where its competitors were promoting the newest of the industry's many attempts to turn you into the controller,
this?
Nintendo of America's Reggie Fils-Aimé stood on stage and
the
said
Wii.
This.
As you know, Retro Studios has produced some great Metroid titles. But when they said they were ready for something new, we asked them to take one of the most treasured franchises in video games.
How's Donkey Kong getting treated today, though?
Make it magic again. If you listen, you can hear it coming.
That music. That landscape.
Yeah, it's Donkey Kong Country Returns. I actually played this game a little bit.
It didn't make any sense. It didn't compute. It seemed impossible.
Yeah, 2010.
Donkey Kong Country Returns.
Stick with the sprites, though. Super Nintendo style. Donkey Kong Country 4,
the fact
and call
that they
it.
Included that country branding was such a good sign. Jungle Beat had just been ported to the Wii.
I don't like the enemies
year,
on this
so
game.
So the way that game went out of its way to avoid referencing the Country trilogy was, like the banana, fresh in everyone's mind. We took it
we,
almost
there
as
we go.
That Nintendo
Stick with
wasn't
that
interested
style.
In promoting or building on anything that Rare had created.
What the
it's
fuck,
It's not like
man.
How the Metroid fandom became extremely cynical.
Yeah,
to
they
want to
make it a little different.
Other that's for
I never played this Metroid
time.
Game.
And that's exactly why this reveal caught everyone so off guard. To have the president of Nintendo of America acknowledge that the series had been mishandled, that they wanted it to be magic again, this
was We don't have the
Kremlins
in this one, though.
Vindicating. Immediately after the conference, of course, people became skeptical of Retro
creatures.
Studios' ability to recapture what made the Donkey Kong Country trilogy so magical after 14 years. Yeah, they weren't turning it into a first-person coconut shooter, but
Not
they also never made anything other than this. We may have been vindicated, but were we selfish? Were we
See
wrong?
The enemies on here?
Hey, it was the 2000s. Let's find out.
Early
the story
2000s
begins,
is pretty
not
good,
on a
though.
Dark and stormy night, but on a bright and cheery day when the active volcano that was apparently beneath Gorilla Glacier explodes. We'll
Damn.
Mourn the loss of Slip Slide Ride, but the eruption has unleashed something far more
that
heinous.
Thing.
The Tiki Tak Tribe. This ancient assortment of sentient flying musical instruments immediately starts hypnotizing the wildlife of DK
oh,
Island
yeah.
and enlists them to, for some reason, steal the Banana Horde. But their particular
bananas
brand of hypnosis doesn't have any
you must
effect
think
on
bananas
Donkey
are that special.
Probably
huh?
because he underwent occlumency training after that incident with the toy factory.
Shit.
And from there, it just goes seamlessly.
Why'd he smile for?
Because the first thing you're asked to do is violently hammer the Wii remote to violently hammer DK's.
Oh yeah, I forgot about this.
No dialogue, no more cutscenes. Given what a sought-after possession the
banana
was,
we don't get dialogue in these games hardly. What are you talking about?
I've always been less than thrilled, though, with the Tiki Tak tribe themselves.
I wish Donkey Kong would talk a little bit.
Antagonists.
He did on 64, I think.
Theming them all around instruments like this, but those masks don't really allow for the expressive characters that made the Kremlings so memorable.
Yeah, see, the Kremlings are better.
Just because they're not the Kremlings, they just.
Where is the Kremlings? What happened to King K. Rool? It never explains, does it?
Flat heads to bounce on, and the designs all kind of run together. But the Tiki Tak tribe's reception pales in comparison to by far the most controversial thing about
how I would have chosen a more intimidating enemy, though,
the
not
waggle controls.
Oh my
in
god.
In 16-bit games, tapping the Y button
there
would make
we
the
go.
Buttons do some kind of rolling attack, and keeping it held would make them sprint.
I love
in
seeing
this. Game,
this.
Your character's speed is determined by the analog stick, which, you know, makes sense. But you don't hit a button to
had a gimmick,
no, don't
though.
Be ridiculous.
The fucking
that
remote.
Would just be silly. No, instead, a function that you'll need to precisely time
I suck
throughout
with the Wii mode. It's hard to control.
Is relegated to flicking the Wii remote. And you know what?
Ugh.
It didn't bother me even a little. No,
it
seriously.
Didn't
it felt like second nature by the second level. I didn't mistime it. I didn't activate it when I
didn't made
want
a lot
to,
of mistakes.
I thought it actually felt pretty immersive when it was used to, like,
Wii
beat
mode.
Up bosses. The reason I was in a position to get the hang of it so fast, though, is because
damn.
By 2010, many Wii games had used a flick of the Wiimote as part of their control scheme. So to me, it was already as natural as hitting a button.
I wish
on
Nintendo
hand,
would just quit putting gimmicks on their consoles.
Some kind of a reason to limit the control scheme to the Wii remote.
That's one of my favorite
Princess
Zelda games of all time, Twilight Princess.
New Super Mario was mimicking the NES controller.
Never
Mario
played
Galaxy
it.
Galaxy required the pointer.
Never played it.
And Mario Kart, amazing as it seems, actually let you use different controllers. But with Returns, you're locked to the Wii remote.
Yeah,
it is absolutely ludicrous that on a system
locked
with a
Wii
controller
Wii
that looks this much like a Super Nintendo pad, a 2D
Wii,
revival
controller
of a Super
good.
Nintendo series couldn't support it. The Force Rival controls might not have bothered me.
I know on Wii U or Switch you get
was
the
a tone deaf
classic
decision,
controller.
They introduced an unnecessary learning curve, and even kept some people from giving the game a chance. If you fall into that camp,
I just played it at a friend's house.
Yes, a few years later. And on that version, all the waggle mechanics are mapped to buttons.
I never played this.
Unfortunately, the trade-off is that it suffers from a much lower frame rate. The Wii version is
should have made it
to
Super Nintendo
steel
sprite style.
The 3DS maintain its target of 30, but it is really
so this would have been a good time to do that.
No other consequences on this hardware.
More
and
people
if you're into that
probably
sort of
would
thing,
have bought it
I really
though.
I really am. The 3D effect is a natural fit for the game too. Some people swear by this version, and there are a few very substantial additions that we'll get to
come
later.
Come on!
But aside from one big one, I take Waggle over a
we
low
need the original Donkey Kong.
Of course, if you've got a beefy enough PC, the Dolphin emulator can give you the best of both worlds and beyond.
I don't know, man. Didn't they take that away?
Dolphin,
any ROMs?
The same controller layout as the 3DS
Nintendo.
Version,
they're brutal savages.
60 FPS with a massive upscale and resolution.
They don't like
and
their fan base.
HD texture pack for the 2D HUD element.
Shit.
It looks gorgeous. Controls perfectly.
I mean, I can understand certain games they want
to. Should be able to.
But they don't support every game anymore.
At this point, I would call this the definitive way to play the game. If your computer can handle it. But
I don't think
even
my computer can handle it. My computer don't even act right
it's
anymore.
It still wouldn't have played like the Super NES games.
When it
this
comes to
games.
This
is not a retro throwback. This is a whole new style of Donkey Kong Country.
Says Nintendo, we're on
his
hat.
A lot of
what?
Things differently. Donkey Kong
what
himself
sound
just feels different. He moves and jumps with the weight and might you'd expect of a gorilla. Dashing from a standstill has a little scampering.
It looks all right
up,
here.
And bouncing on enemies isn't as floaty as it was in the
original.
Also,
yeah,
you can no longer bounce higher off enemies just by holding the jump button. You've got to time it consistently.
Why does he have Diddy on his back?
Combined with how frantic the game can get anyway, I find the window on that is a little too strict. One of the best changes, though, is how climbing works. DKC
there we go.
Ropes,
I keep saying it every time it pops up.
Surfaces that you can clean because
it looks it still looks superior to this
momentum.
Shit.
These surfaces can even
probably
curve,
it's made by
a
Rare.
A lot to stage variety. There's no longer much of an emphasis on barrels. And even aside from the waggle, rolling works completely
differently. Collect the
bananas. In the 16-bit titles, rolling through an enemy would extend both
show
the
better
speed
quality
and
than that. That's an older
attack.
Looking.
It was where a lot of that
looks like
you've
got enough
of
a team. There you go.
Barrel through groups of enemies and build
a little
momentum.
Better.
In Returns, Donkey Kong's roll has been
oh, shit.
Nerfed, really. Rolling and
Dribble. Yeah, they've ruined the Donkey Kong franchise. It's over.
Because rolling is also significantly faster.
Oh, wait a minute. This Tropical Freeze, aren't? Yeah,
so
that's
if
right.
You're going for speed, it's
I don't know too much about that, but I think I've seen Dashy play it a little bit once.
Instead of barraging through enemies with it, it's not a smooth, flowing maneuver anymore. It's an explosive burst of momentum. And unless you jump, it only lasts for this long, whether you hit enemies with it or not. One signature of the classic trilogy was the way that instead of relegating player functions
there
to like a
in-game
menu, a cast
Hell
of characters were attached to those services. Cranky Kong,
you can't say that don't look bad. That looks
the map,
still holds up.
You saved your game, and
they
needs to
be a little bit more widescreen though, but that was back.
Wait, that last one doesn't fit.
Remaster this game.
It's because in Returns, this pig is now your level checkpoint. But
Retro
only captured this particular focus to an extent. The fact is, Cranky didn't just give you hints. He antagonized you and broke the fourth wall. Funky was a dude. Candy was a love interest and an abomination.
Hell
they might
no.
have been one-dimensional, but the Kongs were all characters.
This guy.
This pig, on the other hand, didn't even have a name and wouldn't get one until the sequel. Speaking
what
of Cranky,
lazy
though,
shit.
He's the one helper Kong that actually makes a return
a
in DLC Returns.
Oh, there he is.
While it would have been nice if Mora had made an appearance, I can understand it. All their function had been made obsolete by evolving standards of game design. You can jump
they
around
just
the map
don't
screen anytime, so you
they
don't
keep doing Donkey
the
Dirty.
Auto saves, so you mercifully don't need Candy. All that's really left to do is run a shop.
I don't
and
want
since
to see
Cranky is the most memorable of the bunch, it makes sense that he would get the job. One other signature of the DKC series was its tag team dynamic, and so for the first
Donkey
time
Kong
since
had
1995,
a really good soundtrack.
Diddy Kong was used as DK's sidekick. But the tag team is now more of a Texas Tornado. Diddy isn't really a separate playable character anymore, at least not in single player. You're always controlling
Diddy
Donkey Kong.
Well, Diddy made it big time. He had a few things.
Diddy rides on DK's back, so
he's got Diddy Kong
like
Racing.
A traditional power-up, giving you access to more abilities and going away when
what
he takes enough damage.
Fuck?
Such a change necessitates that those abilities are worth it, and oh, they are. The roll move when you have Diddy is massively buffed. It just barrels
Why
along
does it
the
look
ground
like that?
And can go on as long as the terrain does. And of course,
sitting.
You can still go over a ledge and jump out of a roll. Diddy
what
also comes
fuck?
With his rocket barrels, letting you get more distance and more,
oh, yeah,
more
he has a
control
rocket.
Out of your jumps. But one downside to making
it's
Diddy more of a power-up
than
a second character is that stages no longer have to feature him. It's not uncommon for you to be able to pass a checkpoint
that
with Diddy,
kinda
but if
sucks.
You die, there's no way you're getting him back. It's not necessarily
oh.
a negative.
You don't get him back?
Awkward that the only way to have another shot with him is just to go to another stage and get him.
Okay.
Well, unless you're playing multiplayer. The 16-bit games had a couple different ways to let you switch off in multiplayer, but I
yeah,
never
I remember
covered
that.
Those modes. I mean, it was nice that it was there,
but
it
the color on them.
Tacked on
that looks terrible.
But, I mean, I guess it had to be, given how the games
I don't
were designed,
care about the Game Boy Advance, the DK games.
Both players play co-op at the same time. Unlike the 90s trilogy, and unlike certain newer 2D platformers, it actually
it had to be
part,
for the Wii.
This game was designed with two-player in mind. You never collide with each other, and defeated enemies even stick around for a few seconds, so both players have an
shit,
opportunity
these enemies
to
suck.
Off. The second player can hop on DK's back at any time if a section gets
what
too tough.
What was Kyrule doing during this time?
You can spend a life to come back instantly if one of you dies. The only time it does get a little dicey
no
is in the minecart and rocket barrel stages, but these would have to lose a lot to be playable simultaneously, so I don't mind it. My initial playthrough of this game was pretty much all done in multiplayer, and it was a blast.
It was
this
a
is
big
how you do
blast.
A co-op platformer. The first game had this weird little move called the ground pound. It was fun, I guess, but it was really situational.
It was unique.
You could cover hidden items, but
wrong
not
with
the
it.
Ones that were visibly buried. It was just an odd ability, and it was totally
it
possible to get through the whole game without ever using it. No surprise, the sequels did away with it entirely.
He's Donkey Kong.
Until
he's strong.
Now, the ground pound in Returns is one of the most important moves in your repertoire. It doesn't
I
have that weird
that.
Wind-up and delay anymore. It's totally instant, and it has to be because it's used for so many things. It can still recover items.
At least they
it
got
can
that
also
right.
Stun enemies, demolish terrain, and activate set pieces. It makes a lot of sense bringing Donkey Kong's strength to the forefront.
I remember
of
the final
set,
boss
of
this game,
it. But. Kind of the opposite of the ground pound is the blowing mechanic. Where the ground Shit. Pound feels great and makes sense for the
Stop
character,
saying ground
blowing
pound.
On things is a clunky maneuver requiring you to awkwardly position yourself next to things. It's also huh. more laggy than the ground pound. And I really question what sort of thought process would lead to this being a sensible move
There's
for
There's a pirate
Kong.
Ship back
it's
there.
It's occasionally used for some cool moments.
That should be the Kremlin.
It's used to blow out the fire enemies. But mostly, I just feel like it has too much
so
overlap
would,
with ground pounding.
They should have got wind what was happening here and want to join in and help
the
other bad guys.
So similar, ground pounding and blowing can lead to a lot of starting and stopping. which, Shame. If you let them, break up the flow of the gameplay. You could be totally immersed in the feel of the game,
Boing.
Only to be pulled out if you need to break that thing or blow on that dandelion.
I don't like that ditties on your back every fucking second.
Moments or discovering hidden rooms, but I do feel like stages are filled with way too many background elements
that
only
right.
exist to justify these moves. And I mean, it's at least a plus that each stage archetype Shame. Has its own thing.
They're trying to be like Jack and Daxter here.
But a lot of them don't even give you anything. However, I can kind of excuse this potential interruption of flow for a couple of reasons.
What?
For one thing, it's only potential. There's absolutely no reason you have to search out everything. One of the many things the original trilogy
Yeah, here we go,
was
a superior game.
And allowing the player to choose between action and exploration.
Fast pace,
if you
way
wanted
better.
To barrel your way through levels with all the finesse
Damn.
Of a pounding drum, you'd have a blast.
You say I'm
but
pounding a lot in this
time,
video.
Soak in that
Is there a reason why?
And find all the secrets, that could be just as fun. The game's
I hate doing that. I played this with emulator and I got all of them though.
Captures this balance and it might even do it better in some ways. Every single level is brimming with secret areas to discover
Shit.
And things to collect. But every single level is also designed
bam, bam,
in such a way
bam.
That a skilled player can barrage through them with a speed and grace.
Look at him just going right through
aesthetic.
There.
And in fact, they have to be built with speed in mind. There's
fucking
a new
pig
time
shit.
Trial mode with a ludicrously high skill ceiling, which actually requires you to master every single beat of a level.
Bam.
But maybe the greatest indication of this approach to balance is in two of the collectibles.
Well, it sounds like you don't hate this game.
Puzzle pieces. The Kong letters aren't really hidden. They're in plain sight, but they tend to require the player to pull off a risky move to get them. But they don't grant an extra life anymore.
My only
Instead,
really big problem is the damn Wiimote.
It unlocks a K Temple stage. This is one of those bits of new series lore that really fits.
And I think the enemies are trash.
These revivals
want
these temples to appear. I love the ancient technology aesthetic.
Looks good,
but I
though.
Love playing them even more. Look, the game is normally tough, but these stages just drive you crazy.
Yeah,
they ask
lava.
So much of you. The mechanics all come together.
I don't like
and
underwater
so much
levels.
And pressure, and you just
I don't like
die
deserts.
Over and over again. But it's exhilarating.
Calm down, man.
All that challenge
Aren't you in hell?
Getting to the end so satisfying. But let's set that
what
aside
that, candy?
And contrast that with a new collectible, Puzzle Pieces. And
puzzle pieces
letters,
suck.
You have to actively search for them. They're hidden throughout the stages
Okay, never mind. I
don't
want
puzzles.
But there
are also rewards for completing bonus stages. Collecting them will unlock, well, a bonus. Stuff like a piece of concept
bonus
art or a diorama.
Drugs.
Look, like I said a billion times in the Metroid series, I'm not a completionist. So my approach
yeah,
to
I don't
is
care about collecting every little item.
Them, but
I,
never I
just
want to
beat the game and
that's
it.
I mean, look, the Kongs don't even mind losing bonus stages anymore. But that's kind of the beauty of it. You want challenge?
The beauty.
You'll get more of it as a reward for proving your skill by grabbing those Kong letters.
Which Shit, how long
explore,
is this game?
You'll also be rewarded with bonus content. Do you maybe want to find everything, but you suck at actually doing so, like I do? Cranky
yeah, I'm not good with that.
Who will help seek out puzzle pieces? Is the
I hate it when you gotta collect all the items
Cranky
to get the good ending. In games, that
crashes,
sucks.
Give you more hit points, and even make you invincible. The 3DS version even adds a new mode. Literally,
no.
new mode. Nintendo's
Stop
so
it.
Good at naming things. New mode makes the game easier by giving the Kong
Look how shitty that
items.
Looks.
And if you die too many times in a stage, both versions will even give you the option to just show you how to play it and let you move on. Although you don't get any of the collectibles this way. Watching a game instead of playing
Why
it kind
Donkey
of
Kong
missed the point
like
for
that?
Me. But hey, I was a kid who couldn't beat anything without a Game Genie once upon a time. And there's
Game
wrong
Genie,
with that
yeah, that's the original thing
the
to help
puzzle
people.
Pieces or the Time Attack medals even count towards your completion
Now
percentage.
You gotta collect
I
shit you're forced
approach.
To.
The developers
got no choice.
Give you the freedom and the incentive to play the game in the way that's the most fun for you.
What the fuck?
Of course, I'd find the puzzle pieces a lot more fun if the bonus stages that were tied to were more interesting. Now, I don't have a problem with puzzle pieces in stages, and in fact, some of them are hidden really cleverly.
Hey, when you gotta find a
moments
billion
like this,
items.
Where you have to notice the potential for the background elements to form a certain shape are another indication of what a good fit Retro
wow.
was for this project. But every single bonus stage just
that.
Boils down to grabbing a bunch of stuff within a time limit. And there are only
fuck
a handful
yeah.
of types. Like the aesthetic
time
is the only
limit,
thing that
shit.
Differentiates World 1's bonus stages from World 8's. Even Donkey Kong Country
there
1
we
has
go.
Slightly more variety than this. But I guess the original did also suffer from simplistic repetitive bonus stages. And since we're
Yeah, there's some repetitive shit
in
some of these games.
I can give it a pass.
I like the Super Nintendo games, though.
One way it pales in comparison to the original is in its use of animal buddies. Or to be more
oh,
accurate,
yeah, you got the Rhino, and who
DJC
else?
DJC-1 had four rideable buddies, plus Squawks held a light in that one stage. In return, Squawks
oh, yeah,
is also
that, yeah.
in a support role, and the most famous animal buddy is back. Rambi. True to the game style, he's more powerful
yeah,
than
that's
ever,
the Rhino.
Invincible to everything except fire.
He's always
be
been
fair,
around
he
help.
He's thrilling to play as, crashing through barriers and destroying set pieces, but he's
Yeah, you don't
want to
mess with him, he's fucked you up.
And He's the only rideable buddy in the game. Like I said, I'll excuse some things in light of this being the first game in a new series.
Why does it look like
that? I do still wish there was a way to play as Diddy in single player, or to have him take point.
And have all the rest of them. Buddies, Dixie.
I do think it loses I don't care about Kitty Kong. Momentum, and the ability to switch characters
gives
a little more variety. But in sacrificing this variability, Returns becomes more consistent than the classics. Bottom line is, the game design and the approach
don't compare it to the classics.
But that crunchy core is still there, and ultimately, it's as solid as ever. And boy,
it's not the same company either made it.
I remember when the E3 reveal happened, there was a lot of concern about this.
The heart meter in a Donkey Kong game!
Hearts?
Oh, Nintendo. Caving to those filthy casuals again, are we?
Remember when Nintendo made real games? Hit once and you're dead.
But we were so, so wrong.
You died, man. You got continues.
It might let you take two hits per Kong, but DKC Returns turns out to be exponentially more difficult than its 16-bit ancestors. Nearly every stage
has a gimmick to copy that old-school skill curve.
The concept is introduced, then it's used in situation after situation, ever increasing in complexity, twisting as it goes with other gimmicks to create this exhilarating degree of challenge. Unlike the older games, and obviously unlike most
Indiana Jones style
franchises, DKC Returns actually puts modern hardware to use to create
hazards.
Crash in from the background, flinging enemies and forcing you to seek out shelter. A freaking octopus chases you down through an entire level. Physics are often used
in ways that Super Nintendo wasn't capable of.
With platforms shifting under DK's weight and entire structures collapsing. But even traditional DKC element like blast barrels
are so much more impactful in returns.
Just having a camera that can swing through the environment
gives
a lot more scope. The pace tends to be way more frenetic than the older games, but I think in light of that, people forget that it's not just a bombastic spectacle. This is not like the difference between classic Sonic's momentum and platforming.
That's Game Gear. That don't look all right.
Slower stages based around more traditional platforms.
Which game was
it has
that?
Plenty of ambience. It's just not the same realistic ambience of the original game.
That's what we need back. Donkey Kong Country 4 in that style, Super Nintendo. Make it now. Oh yeah, they can't.
On the flip side, the minecart stages have been so bolstered by the Wii's hardware,
and they probably make it
woke. Superannuate the classics, which makes a lot of sense.
Current shit
sucks. In those original games, these were already the bombastic.
If you don't play real games, folks, go back to the original games.
With hazards and designs that never could have even remotely been done on Super Nintendo. When the drag starts breaking apart or getting cut in half, it can be such an adrenaline rush. It's a testament to how well designed they are that I always feel like I have enough time to react to this stuff.
You still got Tropical Freeze to go still, don't you?
Bury things up now. Minecarts are just a perfect fit for the game style. That ebb and flow between the
platforming and all this spectacle
makes the highs all more thrilling. It really surprised me that a developer who could practically master the pace of
that
a game
made
like
me
this.
Nervous.
Stages never overstay their welcome.
Yeah, that's over the top right there. Intense.
Well,
that's Saudi bikes.
The counterpart to the minecarts are these new rocket barrel stages. They're also linear and vehicle-based, but they're not nearly as well-designed. What kills it here
is,
to be more accurate, the control, because all you can do is hold down the A button to ascend, and you automatically fall when it's not held down. There's this intentional lag that keeps you from changing directions too quickly, so
you better time it right,
folks, to even go in a straight line. Why is all of this screen real estate back here not being used? Oh, it's so they can put things behind you.
What is that?
Now you have to pay attention to dodging obstacles from two different directions with such limited controls when you die in one hit.
Yeah, you gotta dodge that shit from a giant
player. So why not just move the player forward?
Too much stuff on the screen to dodge.
The late game rocket barrel stages in particular are the one time
it
really wore on me. They can be such a repetitive chore to get through. Well,
Donkey Kong games are not easy. This level here on the Super Nintendo. Oh, I hated that level.
It's originating from DKC 3.
It's not easy.
But this style of stage isn't anything like that game's.
Shit.
And the point stands.
DK's Patrol, what?
The music is made up of adaptations of tracks from the original game. Some have taken issue with this, but
they try to take some things.
I mean, most of the level tropes and even the setting itself are the same as Donkey Kong Country, so it feels right for the music to hail from it too.
Especially
since most of them
don't even feel like the original.
And are often put to use in new
ways. It's just got Donkey's face in there.
Like, it's a great touch how the map screen music changes in each world now. For that matter, it's a great touch that the whole map is now just one big model.
Makes
the
whole picture feel
nice and interconnected. Very occasionally, the melancholic TKC tracks don't gel well with the over-the-top approach.
What's those shingles? Well,
introspective aquatic ambience track plays.
Why did they have the water levels on here?
Through pirate ships. There are some new tracks as well, but they don't tend to be nearly as catchy or memorable.
Yeah,
I mean, they're serviceable.
I would have heard it by now.
Greatest hits was the right call. I cannot help but smile every time one of those old familiar tunes would hit. Due to how fast-paced and difficult this game is, it demands
that you get the rat together and
really
bring back that
on
style.
Else when you're playing returns,
but they're not going
to. So much of you, I can kick back, relax, and speed through DKC 2 without really.
I can't speed through this shit. Hell no. Fuck that level, by the way.
Even when it wasn't anymore, the flow of its design has kept coming back all these years. Returns' much higher difficulty, coupled with its decreased emphasis on kinetic momentum, causes it to lose some playability for me compared to the classics. I've beaten the original trilogy dozens of times, but this is only my third time through Returns.
So are they making any more new Donkey Kong games?
But that's not at all a bad thing, and the difficulty really helped Returns stand out in the modern industry. It wasn't going to be able to sell with its graphics the way the original did, so it makes up for that
this
with
this game's
its
not short, I'll tell you that.
Those longtime gamers who loved and mastered those classics. Where the originals immersed
I didn't master
it,
I just beat them.
Parallel at the time, Returns immerses you through its mechanics, the way it forces you to stay
Man,
aware of every
they could have
take.
Brought back the original
if
that's
developer, levels so
if they did it right.
Felt like obstacle courses.
Fuck that
Retro
octopus.
Studios did their homework. An immersive, cohesive design is one of the most critical strengths of the Donkey Kong Country series.
Definitely
that
have to save state with that one.
The original game. It was way ahead of the curve, being realistic.
Show us better quality of this, though, when you show us
that. Anything except cartoony. But by 2010, the industry had figured out atmospheric a little too well sometimes, and so DKC Returns goes for a more ostentatious style. Despite
the bosses
this,
don't look bad, though. I'll give you that.
Rooted in believability. Platforms don't just float in midair, they're connected to the terrain. Now, very rarely I had trouble discerning that terrain from the foreground, like that ledge gets me every time, but the environment and the characters
got a master somehow
are more believable than they ever could have been with pre-rendered tiled backgrounds. At the start of a new stage, you're usually even traversing out
of the jungle.
The attention to world building that Retro proved so capable of in the Prime series made them a perfect fit for Donkey Kong, and it's wonderful to see them get to go in a more vibrant direction. While many of the world themes are inspired by the original DKC, Retro only uses that as a jumping off point. For instance, before you can break back into Crimcroc Industries, you'll have to go through
I didn't play all these levels,
these
I just played like a few.
Are pumping oil into. This area was only previously visible on the original game's map screen, and
there
when you do
go.
Finally get into those factories, they're completely distinct in gameplay and tone from
Hell
the
original. Yeah.
The factory might actually be one of my favorite worlds.
Again with this
There's
fucking background
stages
shit.
Where you switches to
they're overdoing
pockets.
It.
Puzzles that harken back to Retro's prime pedigree, and even a short vertical rocket barrel stage.
Wait, what's
the
this
controls
one?
Way better than the others. Unfortunately, the final world doesn't quite match that level.
Volcano.
It's in the volcano the Tiki's erupted, and while that makes sense within the context of the story,
the
well,
final
look,
boss is a letdown.
The volcano destroyed one of Donkey Kong Island's most iconic frontiers, Gorilla Glacier, and I wish this world had a little more.
K rules better.
I wish it made the player feel the loss and the threat more.
Yeah.
Going back to those gorgeous ice caves, which are now pouring lava and melting as you traverse them, while listening to some menacing, somber remix of Slip Slide Ride.
The soundtrack's always like, "Damn, makes you play it more."
Nostalgia of a player, and gotten them to want to seek vengeance against the enemies who did this.
Holy
instead of
fuck.
That, Returns Volcano is aesthetically just a very generic video game.
Everything's
at least it
generic
is a new
now.
Archetype, compared to DKC1's anticlimactic barrage.
But this ain't a new game,
caves.
Though.
Actually, I guess one neat way of looking at it is that these lava stages from DKC2 have long been rumored to have been designed for DKC1.
I love DK1 and 2
time.
The best.
So I guess
Three's
it's cool
good,
that we finally
good,
did get some kind of volcano on DK Isle. But this world is also the one part of the game where challenge sometimes passes over into cheapness.
Cheap
the final
shit,
world
man.
Definitely be
Oh,
hard.
Man, you're right in the
there's
lava.
There's no reasonable way a player could have seen an obstacle coming unless they just decided to stop.
You're cooking them.
It's too much trial and error. It's still an
yeah, that's a bad way to go
stages.
Right there.
And the final silhouette stage is particularly phenomenal. But the world as a whole doesn't quite feel congruent with the level of quality the game's maintained.
I'm tired of this fucking design here. You overkilled it.
When Retro Studios appropriated and modernized something from the classics, it tended to go well. The ground pound, the minecarts,
there he goes with the ground pound again.
The musical remixes, all of these are spectacular. But when Retro
invented
original concepts for this game, they aren't necessarily bad per se.
It's still not on the level of the Super Nintendo ones.
The blowing mechanic, the rocket barrel, the new music, the enemy designs, and the final world. These all feel comparatively underwhelming.
New enemies
like
suck.
Playing it a little too
the bosses look okay.
And that also
though.
Goes for one more thing. The bosses.
Oh,
most
here we go.
You
want to talk about
bosses
them.
Were a bit dull, but they
yeah,
also
I'll give you that.
Time. As the series went
especially
on,
especially in that first game.
Complex and interesting.
Now, third one had some good bosses.
A skilled player could always tear through any of them in a minute.
Yeah, there's K-Rool right there.
Retro's bosses follow a more modern formula. They go through sequences that scale in difficulty.
What bosses are
I still enjoy the majority of them, but I find they fall into the same trap that a lot of Metroid Primes did. The sequences repeat
I never played one Metroid
times,
Prime
testing
game.
Testing the player for things that they've already proven they can do. It's frustrating,
damn.
Especially in the late game, to
this
die
boss.
To something that you couldn't have seen coming and have to repeat such a long fight. I actually
that
asked
sucks.
One of Rare's writers, Chris Alcock, about returns on Twitter.
What's
without
all
missing
that?
A beat, he made a crack about how long it takes to actually defeat a boss in this game. Though it should
oh.
be noted, he also thinks Retro did a fantastic job bringing back the series, and thank you for allowing me the honor of quoting you, sir. The final
what?
Boss of Returns is the mastermind behind the whole banana thieving plot, Tiki Tong, set at the
Tiki
peak
Tong.
Of DK Island. In contrast to most of his subordinates, I actually quite like his design. He's way more expressive than the rest
he's
of
them. He's just a big
the way
head.
He laughs and taunts the player, makes him come across as unhinged and dangerous. Oh, and he is dangerous. He shoves just a small sampling of the banana horde into his tongue.
Wow.
And then.
The bananas. Wow, banana juice.
Ah, Retro.
This
always
is fucking
expanding
stupid.
More and making it make sense.
I remember this now.
As we learn here, DK's banana horde has never just been a bunch of ordinary bananas. Eating
powerful
gives
bananas.
A massive and magical boost in power, which after 16 years, justifies why Donkey Kong's enemies were always trying to steal them. But the actual
really,
fight
man,
against him is
on.
Another example of Retro being a little too generic.
It's not a
yeah,
cool
does this
boss.
Remind you of anything? Well, yeah, that one's obvious, but
the
ah,
hands.
Yep, there it is. On the bright side, he's tough as nails, and more importantly,
I beat this guy.
Attacks that
never I remember doing it.
They're welcome. As is tradition,
even
the
if,
final
if
boss
I didn't
is
play throughout the whole game.
Beating him triggers an explosion of magical energy that hurtles DK into space.
Into space. I forgot about that
into
part.
Space.
Kazi breathing in space.
What?
Oh, yeah, the moon. You just go with
the
it.
The moon colliding with the planet cause.
What
more,
was K-Rool doing?
I don't know,
he had to have seen
that.
This.
And is it just going to set that? No. Yeah.
Just oh, forget oh, it, okay. man.
This ending, and it pains me to say this, but this ending is even worse than Donkey Kong Country 3's. Like, yeah, dropping an egg on K. Rool was a horrible anticlimax.
I'll
but
choose
at least
that.
It was tonally in line with the rest of the series. Returns tends
Super
to be
Nintendo's
much more
way
over the
better,
top,
always
but
will
in every
be.
Every other instance, it still maintains at least a degree.
I don't think Donkey Kong's meant to have cool
before.
Endings in the first
but this
place.
This ridiculous moonshot isn't even in line with how Returns has presented its world to this point. It veers way overboard.
Reminds me of Zelda
nonsense.
Majora's Mask.
And the moon
with
somehow
moon.
Just flonking itself back into the sky is even
yeah,
worse.
I don't know how
oh,
that
no.
happens.
The horde erupting out of the volcano is a great image to end on.
I guess the moon and, is a weapon.
Look, a golden temple's been revealed. Oh, they are building this thing up.
Oh,
you
really?
Need to beat all of those strenuous K temple stages to unlock it. All right, Returns. I've beaten your worst. What's my reward?
Oh, no. Just a banana?
Huh.
What happened?
No, I don't even mind this.
What
I don't know what was in that banana, but it was definitely magic. So
I thought he was
going to
turn into Super Saiyan
a
Donkey.
Lot than the, ending. The music in the stage even remixes the
this
DK Jr. theme.
Fucking disappointing.
Origins. It breaks hard.
Do we get a secret boss? A secret final boss or
a
something?
Different game. That also means it really stands out. It's
just
one
no.
stage, but you're not gonna forget it. On the other hand, it's just one stage.
One?
It's so built up with cutscenes.
They really
tonight.
Dropped the ball with that.
Like it's gonna be
with
so
the hidden
much more
world.
Substantial than it is, and oh look, it's the 3DS version. There,
the 3DS
still for... ends with that same whimsical stage, but prior to that, it's got an entire world to get through. These stages are, honestly, some of the more brilliantly designed levels in Returns, which is impressive considering that Retro Studios had nothing to do with them. No credit
they
for
really don't understand Donkey Kong or care.
Monster Games. And if they've proven themselves this capable, I wouldn't mind seeing them take the reins of the series if Retro is finished with it. So after all, did this game live up to its promise? Did Retro Studios
I don't feel like
succeed
it did.
In making Donkey Kong Country magic again? Well...
You've been great again.
I've spent a lot of time in this critique comparing returns to the games that inspired.
Still doesn't
there
compare to that.
Things different, things that did better, and things that did worse. But the 16-bit Donkey Kong Country was undeniably the jumping-off point for the game design.
The best.
And so comparing them like this is only fair. However, it is impossible
still
for
looks
to
good.
Hold up to those classics in a way that's remotely fair. Donkey Kong
I will
Country
always say
game
16-bit is great.
22.
But not
Donkey
8-bit
Kong
or
2
before
was a game
that.
That solidified my lifelong love of the medium when I was 8. It doesn't matter how good the newer game is, it's never going to be able to eclipse those memories.
If they just tried and gave a fuck, have the original creators on there.
The originals, even the third one, maintained. The lack of characters,
but not these
and
days.
Buddies, and even the way the
because you see how they want
to
do with games and movies.
The feeling of community,
not going into that shit.
Of style that Rare brought to the franchise. I want to stress
I miss
again
Rare.
That finding what makes a game stick with you is incredibly subjective, especially when you're comparing a game that you played when you were a kid versus
Donkey
when you
Kong's
when you were
made.
An adult. If
they
I had
did like
Returns
on
when I was 8, I don't think I'd have noticed
now.
Any of this stuff. And if I'm being honest,
I can't
a lot
remember,
of these criticisms
didn't
even
Banjo.
Occur to me until the sequel to this game fixed them. So it's not gonna stand up to my childhood nostalgia. So a few things
fuck,
about it
I hate these levels
off.
Design. Just
that
one level would have been
away
okay.
From the fact that for 99% of the game, every time I've played it,
man, I'm exhausted
I've had an
now,
amazing
folks.
Time.
There's a long
it's
video.
So solid, so fun, and most importantly, so, so challenging. To a degree,
yeah, it's
very
challenging, I can tell.
Especially ones that look like this. Find me another game released in the last 10 years.
Now, Tropical
that's
Freeze.
Bright,
that's the next one
vibrant,
now, right?
And this tough.
I don't know
I
how
Retro
good it was.
To take this approach, and
I didn't really.
Their strength as
I didn't play it. Didn't
Rareware
have that
made
console.
Their name by taking Nintendo's concepts and building
fun
Nintendo
game right there.
Heights.
But challenging.
Pun, they were that Rare developer that could actually outplay Nintendo at their own game. And when the sure, two
yeah.
companies aligned, it was pure magic. Retro Studios
yeah,
did
this was
not
magic.
Recapture that magic. But Reggie never said they would. He said they would make it magic again. And in that way,
yeah,
Retro
sure.
Studios is an appropriate name.
How tall is that motherfucker?
They had done before, they proved themselves the masters of understanding the nuance of a franchise.
They try, they put in some work with
this. Before. 2D platformers were making a comeback.
That's Sonic!
But most of them leaned hard
the
on pure old school appeal. There's nothing wrong with that, but Retro Studios isn't
stick
about
with sprites.
Before 20 years
come on,
ago.
Man.
I'd even argue that a straight remake.
I'm tired of seeing Mega Man. I want
to
see Mega Man X.
Counter to what made
in sprite form.
In the first place, so Retro took the risky path, and in doing so, raised the bar of what a 2D platformer should be in the modern era without losing the soul of what made the series legendary.
They just don't learn from history.
A magical game, not because another game was magic 20 years ago, but because Retro Studios made it their own. It is, far away, my favorite game
Super
on
Nintendo.
The Wii. After a
that's your favorite game on the Wii?
Nintendo was ready to make games like this again. Donkey Kong had returned to prominence, and
oh
this
boy.
One game would go on to single-handedly outsell the entire Metroid Prime trilogy.
Really?
At E3 2010, right before Returns was revealed, actually, a brand new Metroid game was shown off.
I wish I had played a Metroid.
If Returns really was that much of a success, then how come when a sequel was announced, those hardcore Nintendo fans who should have loved it reacted
Tropical
like
Freeze.
This?
Tropical Freeze.
Next week, we'll find out when
I can't wait to see that one.
Tropical Freeze.
See how well
for
it did. So there you go, everyone. If y'all want to watch the original video, the link is in the description. Go check it out and shit. Let me get the fuck out here. So yeah, my name is Billy Bob Tanley, and I approve this message.